Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner, available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, I want to talk to you about a topic I've mentioned briefly before, but I think it's becoming increasingly important, and you need to make sure that you are actually paying attention to this. And I do kind of feel like, in many cases, it should almost be criminal if you don't do this with your C++ library. Now, first of all, of course, I want to remind you to check out links to the swag store in the description below, as well as links to my best practices book and my puzzle books that I have created. But I also want to just address briefly whether or not I am using hyperbole when I say it should be criminal to not do this with your C++ library. And this also applies to C, just for the record, and probably Rust and just about any other programming language. But I don't think this is hyperbolic. I think that I'm actually pretty serious here, and I will show you why, hopefully, as we work our way through this episode. So now you've probably clued in at this point that I am referring to fuzz testing. This is a technique for testing your software for vulnerabilities. The general premise is that there's a tool that generates random input into your project, and you execute this random input and check to see if you've got any sort of problem in your code. Looking at the Wikipedia article here, such as crashes, code assertions, memory leaks, etc. So you have to be instrumenting your code, and we've already discussed the sanitizers, and that is a key part of correctly using fuzz testers. And I'm going to show you some very specific examples in a moment. But the general premise, again, is that there's some sort of random string of input. I don't know what it is. That is going into your program in some way. Something like this. And you have your if statements and your for loops and etc. that are being used to process this input in some way. And there's probably lots of code paths through your program that you have never specifically tested for this random set of inputs. And the tester is going to instrument your code and try to find inputs that find novel and unique code paths. So if it finds something that manages to execute the for loop but not execute the if branch here, then it will search for things that do execute the if and things that execute the else case, for example. And my notes here are getting increasingly messy because I'm getting carried away with the fact that I can now write on my screen while I'm recording these episodes. So I apologize for that. This is not a new thing. You really do need to note that, like everything else in computer science, we keep having this scenario of what is old is new again. This was first named fuzz testing in the fall of 1988, which, if my math serves me, is approximately 34 years ago. So I think at this point it makes sense to pull up a couple of specific examples. Now, as always, I'm using Compiler Explorer, and there will be a link to this specific example in the video description below. So again, make sure you check out all the details there. But what I have here is actually very representative of code that existed in ChiScript, my open source C++ scripting engine that I haven't maintained in the last several years, many years ago when I first learned about fuzz testing. The premise here is that I have a parser of some sort. I have a string view input, and I check to see if the first character is an open brace. And if it is, then I continue to read through the input here with this while statement, looking for the close brace, at which point I return the index of this close brace from the function. And if I don't find this matching pair of open and close braces, then I return some sort of error value. Now, this is fairly poorly written, but it's written for the sake of illustration. But again, it is directly taken from an error that I used to have in my parser. If you've been staring at this code, you will have probably observed what the problem is at this point. And the problem is that I have an unchecked loop. I am going to continuously go through this loop looking for a close brace, and it will, if I don't have one, do a bunch of memory reads out in the middle of who knows where. So I have set up this program so that it can be instrumented and tested with fuzz testing. And that is specifically this LLVM fuzzer test one input. This is an input function for the fuzzing sanitizer specifically. It takes a blob of data and a size. Now, this should be fully defined behavior to do this reinterpret cast to const char star, because we are allowed to observe any data through the lens of a character pointer, unsigned character pointer, or byte, according to the standard. Now, if you can link me to a specific place in the standard where this code is incorrect, please do that, but I do not believe that that is possible. So I take this data, I do a reinterpret cast to create a string view, and I send that string view to the parse function. Now, this little dot here and this print statement are simply so that we can get an idea of how many iterations the program is running through before it finds this bug in our code. Now, keep in mind, this code's not going to generate any warnings or errors with Cling Tidy or with any static analysis tool, because it's, well, not any that I know of, because they're just not smart enough to trace through this. Now let's go ahead and take a quick look at how I've set this up. I have wpedantic, wall, wextra, wconversion, wunused, wshadow. I have optimization enabled at the moment, all warnings as errors, and then I have my sanitizer set up as fuzzer, address, and undefined sanitizer. And I had to do this dash FPIE to get it linking properly. So this is Compiler Explorer, and I have it actually executing the code here, in case you're not aware that you can do that. And we don't care about the assembly output, because it has all kinds of address and undefined behavior sanitizer instrumentation that's been added for us. What we do care about is what the actual execution looks like. And we can see that it started with this seed value, because it's random or pseudo-random inputs. And we can see that we actually have an address sanitizer crash, heap buffer overflow, come up quite quickly. And we can see that the crash happens on line 14, which is, well, precisely where we expected to find this bug. That is right here. We can see where the crash happened, that it is a heap buffer overflow. It tells us where the memory was allocated, which was allocated inside the address sanitizer, because we're using a string view here. And we can get the output here, and we can see that it crashed on iteration 254. With the simple string input of open brace. So all it took was that one case of an open brace with nothing following it for it to get a crash. And interestingly, we can take a little bit of a deeper dive in here and just tell it to rerun this execution and see that we got a different seed. And we can see that it took 1,964 iterations this time to find it, and it appeared to be the string of an open brace followed by a new line. So there you have it. That is fuzz testing in a nutshell. I have one other example that I would show you, because I'm sure you're sitting here going, but my library doesn't parse any kind of user input. Well, that shouldn't stop you. Here is a relatively simple exercise. I just want a function that can do some sort of 32-bit rotate. And I have a input value, and I have the number of bits by which I want to rotate this 32-bit input. And again, I have this LLVM fuzzer test one input. Now in this case, I've created a handy little tool for you that says make fuzzed objects, and I want to construct a uint32t followed by an int, taking the input from the LLVM fuzzer test one input, and then I use standard apply. To apply this set of args, which is the tuple of uint32t followed by an int, to the function called rot32. Kind of works like that. I don't think we've ever actually shown standard apply on this particular channel. So it executes as long as it can, and we can see that we have gotten an undefined behavior error because the shift exponent 32 is too large for a 32-bit type. So we can see that this input function is not safe within what is allowed for undefined behavior. And then we get another failure here where the value 2570 is executed, and then we get a signed integer overflow in one particular case. So it looks like we have lots of things that we need to actually test for this function. And again, check out the video description for these links, and you can get access to this link that helps get you set up with this fuzzed object maker thingy. I'll have to be fair, it's kind of slow to compile, but it makes use of many ellipses and lots of lambdas, which, as you know, we love around here. Okay, so on the off chance that you aren't convinced yet, I want to remind you of this security vulnerability that was found in OpenSSL, where someone did a study here to say, what would have happened if I had run fuzz testing on OpenSSL at the time? And at the time, we're looking at only 6 hours of fuzz testing to have found this crash. And if you consider how critical of a piece of infrastructure OpenSSL is, then 6 hours really doesn't mean that much. Now, I would like to also point you to the project called OSS Fuzz, which is a project from Google that does continuous fuzzing of important pieces of open source software. And it fuzzes C, C++, Rust, Go, Python, and Java code using the similar techniques that we've already discussed here. And as of June 2021, we can see that it has found over 30,000 bugs in 500 open source projects. You can see that OpenSSL is one of the projects that is being continuously fuzzed by this project. This is, again, a critical piece of infrastructure. Now I want you to play a simple thought experiment with me. What happens if someone discovers a flaw in libpng that could give an attacker root access to your system in an unfortunate scenario, or in some way cause a crash or a memory error in your web browser or whatever tool is using libpng? Now, if that is found today, it's probably something that would become known as a zero-day exploit, because as soon as this is discovered, approximately every device on the planet has some sort of vulnerability now, because basically everyone uses libpng. So no surprise, we can see that libpng is in fact one of the libraries that is being continuously fuzzed by OSS Fuzz. Which brings me back to the beginning here. And it goes kind of like this. If you aren't fuzzing your own project, someone else is. And if you have a project that is a key piece of infrastructure in your organization, or in a public open source software, then arguably it could be nearly criminal negligence to not run fuzzing on your library, because you have almost certainly security vulnerabilities that someone else has already discovered and has an exploit for. So perhaps I'm overstating this, but I don't think I am. Leave a comment what you think, and please go out there and start fuzz testing your libraries.